Am I still? I think my sound is back on. Indeed, a very warm welcome to all of you. Next to me is Ko Santing, Program Manager of Impact City, The Hague, and Coordinator of this EU project. Ko, we have invited Erik Stam. There are special reasons for that. Maybe you can highlight this. Why are you happy Erik is with us today?
Now, first of all, because I'm a proud alumni of the Utrecht School of Economics, which Erik is the dean of. And second, because our ecosystem model in The Hague, the Impact City ecosystem, is built on his on his academic insights. So I'm really happy that he is here today with us to share that.
Same for me. It's good to have a leading schooler on entrepreneurial ecosystems with us. And a short shout out to Johannes, who recognized our intro song. Sandra Kim from Belgium won in 1986 the Eurovision contest. And there's a big buzz here in the Netherlands because this week the Eurovision is taking place in neighboring Rotterdam. Some practical stuff in the program. We have a presentation by Erik until 12:25, and then there's plenty of time for a Q&A until 12:45, and that's the time we close this session. Please, if you have any questions, put them in the chat. So no raising of hands. The chat is leading in that respect, so maybe Erik can also answer a few questions that he sees in the chat, but that will be done in the Q&A no matter what. And this session is also being recorded, so please be aware of that. That's it from an introduction point of view. I'd like to give the floor to Erik. Erik, the floor is yours.
Yeah, thank you, and welcome everybody to the country of the Eurovision Song Festival. It also triggers some youth sentiments at my side. But I'm sure you don't want to hear me sing and you prefer listening to my talk about the entrepreneurial ecosystem. So that's what I'm going to do today. It's an honor and pleasure to join this meeting to tell a bit more about something we have been involved in and we care about, namely, how can you improve conditions for entrepreneurship and ultimately get more well-being at this earth. To say it more concrete, this is a masterclass on entrepreneurial ecosystems. Now I hope that technology works. Yes. And of course, the question is, why are we not in the Stone Age anymore? And why is a granny talking to her grandchildren at the other side of the world, perhaps buying online stuff, making reservations for her next holiday via Airbnb, paying via the platform Adyen? Perhaps she's still doing online education via Guild Education. She might be listening to Sandra Kim via Spotify. And if she's really naughty, she might drink BrewDog beer. What I want to say to you is that without entrepreneurship, we would probably be still in the Stone Age. And how remarkable is it that we can do all the things, and even your grandmother can still do this via all the activities of high growth startups and the things they have changed and they have offered us over the past years. That's fascinating, isn't it? Of course, the role of entrepreneurship is not something that is of recent times. The founding father of thinking about entrepreneurship, Joseph Schumpeter, already wrote a key publication on this in 1911. We also have big firms in the Netherlands like Philips or Fokker, which once was the leading one of the leading European aviation firms. But the intensity, the speed of which entrepreneurial activity occurs in the last decades has really been much more astonishing than ever in the history of mankind. And then here you look at firms like Airbnb, but also in Europe, BlaBlaCar, Spotify, BrewDog, Adyen. And why am I putting this into a map? Well, perhaps some of you might still remember, if you're from the 80s or 90s, Joschka Fischer, the Minister of Foreign Affairs in Germany, and he said if Bill Gates would be born in Germany, there would have been no Microsoft. So seemingly, national, regional conditions have something to do with the prevalence of entrepreneurship. And it surely does. Here you can see the map of the prevalence of unicorns, like the firms I just mentioned, around the world. And you can see that this is highly uneven spread around the world. So you have countries like the Netherlands, Sweden, the UK, which have a fair amount. of course, you have countries like Estonia and more in particular the US, Israel, which have very high numbers of these kind of extremely successful firms. So the geography of entrepreneurship is very uneven, and that also tells you something, that the geographical conditions probably matter a lot, even though perhaps individual entrepreneurs won't recognize that. If you look at the world from an entrepreneurship point of view, you see that the conditions for entrepreneurship are very different, and it also explains to some extent why there is such a difference in entrepreneurship prevalence around the world. You can also focus on Europe and say, well, you shouldn't look at countries, but at regions, and rightfully so, because you can see that it's not the whole of France that produces unicorns, especially Paris, Amsterdam in the Netherlands, Munich, Berlin, Tallinn, Stockholm. But this is a very extreme measure of entrepreneurship. Of course, you can take much more inclusive measures. So the number of innovative startups per 10,000 inhabitants, then you can see it's somewhat more equally spread around Europe, but still highly uneven. And of course, the question is, does this matter to you? Well, I guess, otherwise you wouldn't be here at the online masterclass, but it matters for every self-respecting city and region, because they are all thinking about how to improve their conditions for startups, Startup Berlin, Startup Stockholm, Startup Amsterdam, Impact City, your host today. They all have all kind of initiatives to improve the conditions for entrepreneurship, not because civil servants need to become entrepreneurs. Well, perhaps they can become a bit more entrepreneurial, but they especially take their role as an enabler of entrepreneurship seriously. And nowadays, this has been called building or developing ecosystems. Everybody seems to like it. Well, if you look at these pictures, this is quite agreeable. But of course, this is just the metaphor or the analogy. The analogy is important because it looks at how things grow organically, how things are interdependent. But we should also be aware of the limits of this natural metaphor, because entrepreneurship is much more creative than the behavior of animals. And for example, institutions and culture play much more and nuanced and I would say frontal role in social systems like entrepreneurial ecosystems. By the way, there's some nice piece of art in my screen. I don't know whether you see that as well. Something that occurs organically, seemingly. Being a scientist, we can of course all talk about ecosystems and like it, but if we don't define it, there will be a sort of a Babylonic language, and everybody has its own interpretation. And if you want to improve it, and if you want to get together to improve it, you need to have a definition. That is of course also what we as scientists do. So we try to define entrepreneurial ecosystems as a set of interdependent actors and factors governed in such a way that they enable productive entrepreneurship within a particular territory. So it's different than old school economics in the sense that a lot of these elements are interdependent. So you cannot just push one button and then expect entrepreneurship to rise. There is a lot of interdependence within the system. It looks at governance, which is, let's say, different than natural systems, in which there's not a sort of bottom-up or top-down governance from humanity. And we look at the particular type of entrepreneurship. So you might say the Italian mafia is full of entrepreneurship, but that is not really productive for society. So we look at types of entrepreneurship that also add up to the aggregate value creation in society. And it's very often a very territorial phenomenon. And whether that's a city, the city region, or the country, that is something open for discussion, but it's not equally around the globe. And it's also a lot of these mechanisms underlying ecosystems, like, for example, talent, capital, are very much limited to particular territories. And you can, yes, you can summarize this into one model. By the way, this is not something I sort of invented in a class of art, but this is really a reflection of decades of academic research on entrepreneurship and economic development. If you put all this research together and ask yourself the question, what are the conditions that are needed for entrepreneurship to flourish in a particular territory and for that to lead to prosperity? There are at least 10 elements that are known to be important and need to be in place for entrepreneurship to flourish. A bit like Joschka Fischer said, if those elements are in place, they are well established, it's much more likely that there will be productive entrepreneurship than in places, regions in which they are not in place. So former institutions, sometimes we forget about it, I think especially in Northwestern Europe, that having a proper rule of law, good governance is extremely important for having productive economic interaction, a culture that values entrepreneurship, that values success, excellence, networks, so the degree to which people are connected, organizations are connected, which enables the flow of all kinds of resources, having a physical infrastructure, demand, intermediaries, talent, extremely important, of course, having a presence of talent that can start a business, but can also join businesses and join new initiatives, investments in knowledge, leadership that brings people together, has a puts a vision on the map, enables collective action, and last but not least, finance. And all these elements enable productive entrepreneurship in particular places, which ultimately leads to prosperity in a broad sense. You can say, well, this is a nice framework for analysis, but what can we do with that? Well, my claim is that it's a framework for analysis and action for each and every region to improve their own economy. And I will expand on that a little bit more later in this masterclass. The good thing is we are living in the age of big data, so you can also measure all this. This is also not rocket science. If it would be rocket science, we would have perfect measures. It's a social science, but we have much better data now than we have 10, 20, 30 years ago. And we put everything we knew or could source for European regions into one big data set. So there are tens, if not hundreds, thousands of data points for all the European regions. And just let me give two examples. Physical infrastructure, that's a combination of transportation infrastructure and digital infrastructure. So we measure the accessibility by roads, the railway and number of passenger flights, but also the digital infrastructure with the percentage of households with access to internet, which is an extremely important context condition. You can also say talent is of course key, but we measure human capital in 8 different ways. So we try to measure each element as broad and as deep with the data available as we can. And the good news is that we are improving on this. The bad news is it's not rocket science. We don't have perfect measures yet, and we will never have. But if you take all these measures together and compute them into one index, I won't dwell into details on how to do that. You can read stuff that we've published on the web. You can see that an average region in Europe has a value of 10. You can see that the Romanian, Southern Italy, Greek regions have a far below quality of entrepreneur ecosystem the way we measure it. But regions like the South, so Munich, the London area, the Amsterdam area, the Paris area, Stockholm especially, Copenhagen, Helsinki perform very high. And this is a quality measure of the conditions for entrepreneurs. So this does not measure entrepreneurship itself. Let me be clear about that. These are the conditions that enable entrepreneurship to flourish. And of course, I already hear you thinking, well, to what degree is this related to entrepreneurship? This is something that is action that evolves out of this. Here you see the prevalence of startups per 10,000 inhabitants, a map that I showed you earlier on. And then, of course, the academic question is to what degree is this correlated? Again, this is not rocket science, because then we would see a perfect correlation. But there is quite a strong correlation. So if you have a low quality entrepreneurial ecosystem, there's also a low entrepreneurship output. And if you want to have a high entrepreneurship output, you'd better have an above average quality entrepreneurial ecosystem. But I think the main piece for today is something, what can you do with this? And I would say, well, just striving to have more unicorns is not the game you need to be into. The game you need to be into is to think about what are the strong or weak points of my ecosystem and how can I improve this? And that is really why the entrepreneur ecosystem is a framework for analysis and action, to look at your own region, to have a better diagnosis of where the strengths and weaknesses are, to have a better dialogue with stakeholders on this, both its objective diagnosis, but also enriched with their local knowledge about the local conditions. So representatives from the knowledge institutes, from banks, from local governments, but also entrepreneurs themselves, they can enrich this dialogue and then come to a consensus. What is the weakest element in your system? Tackle this with a particular policy instrument, which you can get inspiration from around the world, implement this. And then of course you want to see to what degree that also leads to the envisioned changes. And let me use the traffic light metaphor here. you can use all this data, use it for your region. This is a not so hypothetical region in Europe. And we show the strong points of this region, so on which it has an above average quality, so to say. So physical infrastructure, demand, knowledge, that's going pretty well in this region. It has some elements that are, let's say, average, intermediaries, leadership, formal institutions, culture, networks. But now it gets interesting. So what are really the weak elements in this region? Talent and finance. And we put this on the map in this region, and we also confronted civil servants, but all kind of feeders of the ecosystem and also entrepreneurs. Do you recognize this? Well, they recognize finance. They were a bit surprised about talent, but once we talked more deeply about this, they gave more nuanced element, or let's say specifications of what kind of talent was missing in the region. And then you have to come to a consensus. Well, what are we going to tackle in this region? Well, certainly not physical infrastructure, because that is doing very well. So let's focus on talent, perhaps in combination with finance. And then you have to look, well, how can we tackle this with public and private parties in the region? Where do we get our inspiration for? And then we need to implement that, which very often is a public-private affair in entrepreneurial ecosystems. And then, of course, you also need to trace to what degree the envisioned changes in the ecosystem are achieved. And then you also need to have this measurement framework in place to learn why you didn't achieve that. And if you achieved it, which is quite rare because a lot of other things happen in the meantime, what will be the next weak element that you need to tackle? Well, you can also put this into a picture. I would say the entrepreneurial ecosystem framework enables a collective learning process to improve your economy. So it's a generic framework, yes, but it allows you to plug in very specific data about your region to start a diagnosis with that, which is just a starting point for a better dialogue with the local stakeholders, in public, private, entrepreneurs, ecosystem feeders, and also users, so the entrepreneurs, and then come up to a policy objective, which is very specific for your economy. So what can you tackle to make the system better? Then you have to choose a policy instrument to really do it, to implement it. And then, of course, you need to evaluate. This is a process that goes on and goes on. I'm afraid it's just like science. It's never ending because there are always weak points in your ecosystem that deserve attention. But it's also a way to learn collectively about your economy and to improve it. If you want to read a bit more about this, there's a lot of stuff on the web, and I'm sure this will be shared with others. And if you don't like reading, you can also watch a lot of stuff. We have a course with a lot of lectures on this. But for today, I would really love to get in conversation with you about how you can use this framework to improve your own economy in your own specific way, and how you can get better dialogues between stakeholders to get this collective learning process running. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Erik, for this.